Alright, hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. This is Rob here at Smirking Gun Reviews, and like I promised at the end of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Fans of S.H.I.E.L.D., I said, the show might be over, but we're going back. We're going back and continuing the old Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. new reviews that I used to do. And we're even putting a little gloss on it now that I make thumbnails better. And so this basically is the series, old reviews. And we're starting where I left off with Season 3, Episode 4. It's called Devils You Know. Sorry, my hat is bugging me. So thank you to anybody who watches these. Gets your weekly dose. Gives you a reason to go back and rewatch the old episodes. Also, it's good for me to be doing this because Dee and Don Willie, my people who do Fans of S.H.I.E.L.D., on Darren's channel, D's Reviews. We're going to be doing season by season, best of each season. And we're also going to be doing Agent Carter. So it's nice right now for me to definitely, season three, I should have some pretty good picks for my choices for season three when we do it. It's going to take a while for us to get all of our ducks in a row because we want to make sure that we give you guys the our real best of the best and maybe the worst. We haven't pinned it all down quite yet, but look for that in the future. But until then, we're talking old Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And Devils You Know is a really good place to jump back in. Because we're only four episodes deep in Season 3, and it feels like we're halfway through a season when you watch an episode like this. This one is firing on all cylinders, and it makes me so nostalgic for the way that they used to do the show. The show's always been great, but I really miss when we were on the ground, on Earth, doing cases, doing missions. You know, we hadn't gotten so big yet that, you know, it just each season kept getting bigger and bigger. And right here in Season 3, we're right on that cusp of where, you know, before the framework, before Ghost Rider, you know, we've still got Bobby and Hunter on the team. We're still dealing with Ward. We're still dealing with Hydra, you know, but this is also after Simmons got taken by the monolith and has come back and not telling Fitz and anybody the whole story. We've got Andrew hiding a very big secret. Spoilers, you know, if you don't know. Like, you know, if this is your first time watching it, I won't say anything. But Andrew is played by Blair Underwood, who's fantastic in the role. He's got his own secrets. And you got Rosalind and the ATCU and the guy who played Ennis from Perry Mason's on the team, doing work with Coulson, very much to Daisy's, you know, chagrin, and the rest of the team. Them, Rosalind's ATCU is trying to stop Inhumans. Coulson's trying to recruit and help them, and they're trying to work together like means to an end, but it's not a popular opinion by either side. All right. But it is it's nice to see Coulson and Rosalind play off each other. You can tell there's an attraction there, especially with May leaving at the end of Season 2 and now kind of working with Hunter as he's tracking Ward to try to kill him for what he did to Bobby and himself and everyone. And so there's a lot going on. And like I said, four episodes deep. That's it, guys. That's all. And this just... Man, I miss old S.H.I.E.L.D., and it's so fun to talk about. So, like I said, this episode, though, it hits a lot of things. It gets us moving further ahead to what is going to be happening in the next bunch of episodes. Like, next episode is 4,722 hours. It's the big what happened to Jemma when she went through to the monolith, and that's episode 5. So, with Lash, the guy who's killing Inhumans, you've got Ward and Hydra, you've got Jemma and the monolith stuff that's going on, and then you've got Rosalind and the ATCU. But none of it feels like they're trying to put too much in here. It's giving everybody on the team something to do. The only person I think that really doesn't have much to do is Mac, probably. But, you know, Mac gets plenty to do later on. But like I said, I miss this old S.H.I.E.L.D., and that's why it's so fun to be jumping back in. Now, we start this episode with Alicia, who'd come to S.H.I.E.L.D. Previously, she had been, you know, part of the whole Inhuman group that's been splintered now after season two, and they've all been running. But they don't all know that the Terrigen Mist had gotten out, and Alicia comes to some friends to tell them that it has. But before they can get too far, they find out that there was this email they got, and Alicia wants to see it. Well, boom, as soon as that happens, there's Lash. Bigger than life, kills all of them. And you think that Alicia's dead too, but what happened is Alicia sent one of her others. She's the multiple girl. And so she's alive, but she's hurt. Dead, and her multiple has died. And so, you know, this was supposed to be a recruiting mission. Coulson had sent her in there to talk to Inhumans out so that they could help them, protect them, because he's killing them all. But at the same time, it's also kind of protecting them from Rosalind and ATCU, because whatever they're doing with, you know, Inhumans, we don't know. You know, they could be building their own army. That's what Coulson and them want to know. It's whole why they're keeping this enemy close. And so, but Mac and Daisy are out tracking Lash. And I love this because this is old Mac. They're in an old dark. You know, they're in a dark alley or hallway. They're talking about Jaws. Mac has a good way of, like, freaking himself out. He's always putting himself, whenever he's in one of these kind of horror movie moments, I love it. Because, you know, it's the big guy, but, you know, he's got that kind of scared little guy inside him at the same time. You know, you got Daisy next to him who, yeah, she's got powers, but usually in the situation on a show, it would be the girl being like, I don't know, but no, it's the guy. And I love that she's the one who's like, do I have to take point? He's like, I'm going. But what they find out is that at the end of the hallway, it's not Lash. It's Rosalind and the ATCU coming to try to find Lash as well. And there's Coulson as well. And when Daisy sees that Coulson's there, it doesn't help, actually. It actually makes Daisy go, why are you with them? Why are you standing there with them? We don't really trust them. But this is kind of a running theme. Daisy is relentless with her questioning why they're working with these people. Which is fine, you know, which is absolutely understandable because she's an Inhuman, you know. She's got a lot going on with somebody killing Inhumans. The whole thing that had just gone down with her mother and her father and all the other Inhumans, and now she's got this person that she doesn't trust working so closely with them that, you know, has got dubious things going on about what they're doing with Inhumans. Now, meanwhile, Hunter's mission to infiltrate Hydra is getting closer and closer to Ward as he delivers a bunch of guns that Ward can use to fight S.H.I.E.L.D., to help bring down S.H.I.E.L.D. Ward here is played by Brett Dalton, who's always excellent, is, again, showing how messed up he really is. Now he's using references that S.H.I.E.L.D. would use, saying things like level 7 and making them call him the director. I love this shot there. It's like he's not gotten over it. He just wishes that things could go back to the way they were. I think deep down, as fucked up as Ward is, he really just wants to go back to normal, but he knows they can't. So if he can't have S.H.I.E.L.D., then no one can. He's just going to tear it all down because he's a spoiled little brat and a psycho to match. He's gone completely off the reservation, and he's finding like-minded people that don't really quite, I think, ever understand Ward's psychosis. They're a bunch of mercenaries, you know, that kind of just want that kind of chaos as well. But May, in the meanwhile, you know, she's trying to help Hunter. She's impatient because he doesn't have any intelligence, that he's kind of going in half-cocked. You know, she wants a little bit more control, but she's also worried about him, too. Because his will for revenge of what happened to, you know, him and Bobby and what he almost did to them and her, what he did do to her with torture, has got him not really thinking too much about his own safety. And so it leads May back to going back to Coulson, which I know she didn't really want to do at the moment. But she has no choice because he's going in no matter what, to kill him. So at least going back to S.H.I.E.L.D., she can ask Phil what's going on so that Hunter doesn't go in there on a suicide mission. But Daisy, meanwhile, her and Bobby give Coulson a briefing about tracking that email to a guy who works at the Social Security Administration named Fry. That's right. I've got all these notes written down. But Mac thinks that, you know, the killer, he's like a gray white shark, but what Daisy feels like is if he's got people working for him, he's not like some mindless animal. He's hunting. But what they don't understand is where is he getting the names? Sure, if you give a name to the Social Security agency, they can track somebody down. But why? How does he have those names in the first place? Now, why nobody hasn't thought that the word used the word mole yet? I don't know. But that's the word they should be using. Especially because, you know, Andrew being very inquisitive about Inhumans and people not taking his recommendations, but mostly how he kind of pushes about the Inhumans and allowing them to go on missions that weren't cleared by him, wanting more access to the Inhumans. And now that I'm rewatching it, it's kind of, you know, staring them all right in the face. But nobody wants to see because everybody just sees Lash as this great big monster. Simmons, meanwhile, is with Andrew, trying to work through her therapy of what happened to her while she was gone on that other planet. And she's holding back and holding back, and this is a great scene, and it shows that Andrew is a good therapist. He just, you know, he's got some problems. practicing Fitz during... Okay, so yeah, Fitz without Simmons. Okay, Fitz without Simmons is driving Bobby nuts. And it's like, you know, he's got the shorthand with Simmons and somebody else trying to step in. It's like when somebody tries to step in at my job, right? Like for a day and I come in and I'm like, no. This goes here, that goes there. How are you not getting this? I absolutely get it, but I also absolutely get why it would drive Bobby nuts. But Fitz finds Jemma's notes that she's been taking about all about what's going on with her and the monoliths. And Jemma sees this, wigs out, stay away from my stuff, because Jemma just can't figure out how to tell Fitz yet everything that she's holding on to, why she wants to go back, because none of them know that she wants to go back except for Bobby. Because, and if you haven't seen this before, I don't really want to spoil it, but, like, things got weird over there, and we do find out everything next week. Well, you did find out everything the week after this episode aired. We're going to talk about it next week. But there's a lot of baggage there that, you know, hurts a lot of Fitzsimmons fans for a little while. But they find out, Daisy finds out that the other Inhumans did get the email. Finds out by going to that Banks guy who plays Ennis on Perry Mason that the other Inhumans got the email. Nobody just knew to look for it. They find out that there's this guy named Dwight Fry, and when they track him down, his power is being able to detect other Inhumans. But when he does it, it's his power basically hurts him. And so he's been working with Lash because every time he kills one, his pain gets lessened. Now, I don't know how you, with as many humans as would be out there, I don't know how you gauge how much pain level you go down by just killing one or two. But apparently it's enough to notice. And so that's why he's working with him. And he's convinced that Lash is what he's doing is helping, because if, you know, not everybody wanted their powers, and if you had his power, and I actually understand this guy where he's coming from, is that if you had the kind of power he had where it actually is hurting you just to be around your own kind, that's the only skill that has. And I also like that it kind of tracking people and working for the Social Security agency is linked to it. I love how if you really kind of look at everybody's powers, a lot of them have something to do with something in their lives. It's pretty interesting, right? And you could say that sometimes about like the X-Men too. But so they take him out of there after he tells them everything. And they get this joint operation, right? And they try to get him out of there. But Daisy and Mac go with Fry to make sure that he gets there safe, but also to start figuring out what Rosalind and the ATCU are doing with Inhumans. But unfortunately, they don't get that far. Because there's a Lash attack. He knew where they were going. He knew where to be. Again, red flags should be flying everywhere at this point. Again, looking at it from the perspective of us knowing where everything's going as an audience member. And Daisy attacks back, flips the truck, but it doesn't stop Lash from getting Fry and killing him. But not before, you know, Fry tells him, look, I just told him the truth that you're being merciful. But he's like, I'm not merciful. I'm necessary. Where he's like the Punisher for Inhumans, and he kills Fry. But Daisy, dazed and confused, before she passes out, sees that Lash turns into a person. Now, of course, conveniently, it's in shadow because it's episode 4. We don't want to tell everybody what we already know if you've seen this already. And again, you know, it's just one of those things that this show did a lot. But what I do like is that they parcel it out, but like the pods that we've talked about, that they do keep the show, you know, the storylines fresh, so that even though they'll stretch out certain things, other things they'll reveal, and they'll always have enough moving parts and new things and reveal some stuff and hold some stuff back, that you never feel too much like they're dragging it out. And especially when they do switch, you know, like through halfway through, they'll switch the main arc of the show. So that's always nice to know that that's, you know, even though the Lash thing doesn't get quite figured out for a while, there's always something else happening to keep your attention and keep you going, oh, but what about this? Meanwhile, the whole thing with Ward comes to a head. They all make their move. Now, the thing that, the only part about this I didn't like is when, you know, Hunter goes in, he gets to meet Ward, Ward knows his face, cover's blown, he just turns, and of course there's this firefight, he doesn't shoot Ward, there's a big standoff, and the cavalry arrives, you know, May does a great entrance as always, backflipping into the action, shooting a bunch of guys on her way in, and there's basically a standoff, and she's there, and Hunter's there, and Ward's pinned down. But when they call Coulson, we're 20 minutes out still. I kept thinking to myself, come on, 20 minutes, like it's just, it feels like, you know, because the plot needed them not to be there. So, you know, it's always, you know, this is where I got a little, not annoyed, but just when you know that the story is purposely keeping, you know, things from happening. Because then, you know, again, you don't have the story. The story happens, it gets resolved too quickly. But then you don't get to have Ward and Hunter and May have their own standoff where Ward, always the shit, always, always talking shit. You know, tries to get on both of them. He tries to get Hunter to react by trying to make Hunter feel, you know, less than. You know, like that Bobby's the one that, you know, the stronger one in there, and just trying to make him make a mistake. And when that doesn't work, he plays with May's head and shows her a phone of Andrew that's being surveilled by young Strucker and some of his goons, that some sort of contingency plan that he had already working, that if he ever were to get caught, he would at least have, you know, something over on May to get him to walk away, or her to walk away. And she is. She's going to let Ward walk. But Hunter saying, look, he's got all these guns that we gave him. We gave him these guns. He's going to use them to hurt a lot of people if we don't stop him right here. And it's where It may be reckless, but Hunter knows that killing Ward will save more lives than Andrews. You know, it's the bigger picture. And so he makes his move. And while he doesn't kill Ward, he does shoot him in the back. Which, you know, is something, you know. They had to give us something. I remember the promos for this episode where it was like Ward versus Hunter and all for, you know, for all the marbles, right? You know, for all revenge and, oh, something's got to happen. So they let him shoot him but not kill him. But, you know, if you actually think that those, you know, stranger things have happened on S.H.I.E.L.D., but Ward was not getting killed in episode 4. And then Strucker. Young Strucker and the guys with the gasoline. Something bad happened in that store. Gasoline's pouring everywhere. Strucker gets away. The place explodes. And we're to assume that Andrew died in the store with the rest of the guys. Now, of course, no body, no death. So if you actually thought Andrew was dead here, I feel for you. It's one of those things, though, that cliche of no body, no death. That just, it's gotten a little stale. You know, it's basically you always know that somebody can always come back. It's an old trope. And I don't know. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. This time it's a little like, you know. But at the very end, Jemma finally, you know, Fitz kind of pushes and tells Jemma, why are you doing all this? Why are you building or writing down all these schematics to build another portal? And she finally says, I've got to tell you everything that happened over there because, you know, I need you to understand why I have to go back and why you have to help me build it. And that's where it ends. So that's the end of Devils You Know. We will be back next week with 4,722 hours. So if you like this review, please hit the like button. If you're not already a subscriber, please consider becoming a subscriber to the channel. And thanks for watching. We'll be back next week for more Old Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. new reviews. Bye.